Recently, I've been getting a lot of messages and questions from a lot of you wanting to know where to put your money. And I thought that was really interesting because on this channel, I talk so much about saving money, but I don't ever really go into what's next. Like, what do you do with the money you save? And I've had the opportunity to speak with quite a few of you on Zoom just to hear more about your financial frustrations and what more I could do to help. And pretty much everybody I talked to had their savings on point. I'm talking about several thousands of dollars in their savings. First of all, good job. I mean, seriously, you guys are doing great. It's really good to get to talk to people who are in the same mindset, who are like-minded people who are always looking to improve their personal finances. And I just want you to know I'm really happy for all of you. But what that made me realize was I don't really talk a lot about what to do after you save the money. So in this video, I'm going to go over the steps I've taken throughout the years that not only improved the way that I manage my personal finances, but also the amount of money that I have in multiple different places. Pretty exciting stuff. Now, I'm not the richest guy in the world, but I have some big money lessons to teach you. And by the end of this video, you'll walk away with everything you need to know to start building the life that you've always wanted. By the way, my name is Reggie Bryant, and if you're new here, welcome to the channel where I show you how to save money and increase your income. And today I'm going to show you what to do with the money you've been saving. I'm about to walk you through my personal finance journey just as I experienced it as a young man just trying to figure everything out. And my hope is that my story enlightens you and my setbacks and roadblocks I had along the way make your financial journey that much easier. And of course, I'm going to tie that in with the best places to put your money. So let's get into this. So first of all, before I ever got paid throughout any period of my life, I knew that at least 10% of my money was going to church. And I knew as I got older that I was going to be sending my mom money every time I got paid. That's not negotiable. I'm not saying that's what you gotta do, but that's what I do. And throughout the course of my life, what it's done for me is it's given me an abundance mindset when it came to money. Plus, it's a good thing to do. Anyway, when I moved out on my own for the first time, I felt this immediate pressure to have a certain amount of money in my checking and my savings account. And I quickly realized that I had trouble figuring out how much money should go in each account. Now, I don't know about you, but something that I can't stand is not knowing, especially when it comes to money. So knowing that I didn't know how much money should go into my checking or savings account really frustrated me. It even gave me some anxiety because of the same reason you're watching this video right now. I didn't know where to put my money. Now, of course, with anything personal finance related, your money's gonna start off in your bank, but it doesn't have to end there. If you choose to do that, that's cool, but if you really want your money to grow, and if you really want to build the dream life that you've always wanted, you have to open your mind up just a little bit, the same way I did. But first, I had to get past the trickiest part for me, and that was having a healthy balance of money in my checking and savings account. So what I learned pretty early on was that I just needed to focus on one of them and give it a goal. And sometimes this can take you a couple of months to do, especially if you're just getting started on your own, but that's what worked for me. So I already had it in my mind that I was gonna set aside $200 a month for my savings. And that was until I felt comfortable enough to add more to that. And in the meantime, I was focused on building up my checking account because you never know what's gonna happen. So I always felt the need to have that money that I could easily access at any time just in case I needed it. Even though this stuff I'm talking about is very basic, it was a real struggle for me because I found myself putting way too much money in my checking account. And this was even when I had my savings up to $10,000. I just had a very hard time keeping them balanced. And yes, there's a such thing as having too much money in either account because it makes you miss out on other opportunities and other places you can put your money that I'm about to go over in a second. But it also makes you think like, oh, I actually have a lot of money. I can spend some of this and not have to worry about anything. And even though this way of thinking happens at a very subconscious level, even the most disciplined of people go through this. I'm very disciplined, but I still fell victim to that way of thinking because all that money was right in front of me. At least with my savings account, I could say, hey, that's my savings. I'm not touching that. But it was that slight difference of having all that extra money in my checking account that actually ended up being one of the many reasons that I wasted a lot of money. I had a good $3,000 in my checking account at the time, and I had to realize, for me, that's too much, because I mess around and spend it. Don't let me get around no Jordans, no video games, or Polo Ralph Lauren, because if I do, it's a wrap. I'm sorry. So I realized I needed to take that money and move it somewhere else. So I put most of that money into my savings account and I knew I wasn't gonna touch my savings account. So once I got my checking and savings account under control, a couple months had already went by. And the way that my job was set up, you couldn't put any money into your 401k until you were employed there for 3 months. For those of you who don't know, a 401k is a retirement account that your job sets you up with. And you either have the choice to hold on to all your hard-earned money or you can put some of it into your retirement account, which grows over time. Most people skip over this and say, ah, I'll do it later. But what I've seen time and time again is that's not the way. Because how often do you tell yourself you're going to do something later and you actually do it? Come on, let's be honest now. Exactly. And your 401k is a place your money needs to go if your job offers it, because in the future, you'll thank yourself for having it. Don't be that man or woman who wants to retire at 65, but then you look at your retirement account and ain't nothing in there. So here's my background with 401ks. I didn't even know they existed until I was 21 going on 22. And by the time that 3 months rolled around and I was able to finally invest in my 401k, I didn't know what the heck I was doing. I didn't know any better. I didn't have much guidance, and I definitely didn't know how much money I was supposed to be investing. So here's what I came up with. I looked at my company's 401k plan and I saw that they match you once you put in at least 4% of your paycheck. So I was like, cool, 4% it is. Look, something you'll hear a lot of people say is max out your 401k, max out your 401k. From the very beginning, I've never agreed with that. First of all, if you maxed out your 401k right now, you would be giving $19,500 per year. That right there is about half of the average person's salary, so that's not gonna cut it. We got bills out here. Even though I didn't know much about personal finance back then, I pretty much knew that if I put 4% of my income into my 401k, then my company was going to match me, which meant that they were going to give me free money on top of what I was already putting in. And since I was only 21, I knew my money would grow a lot by the time I hit retirement age anyways. And since I made that decision not to max out my 401k, that freed up more money for me to explore other investment options, which is something I always wanted to do. But to be honest with you, in the meantime, I also just wanted to enjoy my life. I mean, I came out of college making $65,000 a year in a city where the cost of living was super low. So your boy felt rich. I felt like that for a good month. And then my work life kind of turned upside down, you know. I just ended up having a really bad experience. And I saw managers and leaders of the company using scare tactics, threatening to fire people. They even walked a few people out right in front of me. And this stuff was over slight mistakes. And that was when I realized, this is all temporary. All right, things are going pretty good today, so I'm going to be able to keep my job today. But now I need to figure out how I'm going to survive tomorrow, because if I mess up tomorrow, it's game over for me. That's how I started thinking, right? So I started to build a savings fund inside of another account because I wanted to start making what I call a loss of income fund. This was in case someone wanted to act crazy at work and walk me out. I thought in terms of the worst case scenario. I was like, okay, cool. So I have $12,000 in my savings account. I'm not touching that for anything unless there's an emergency. And I wasn't talking about the emergency where your job lays you off or fires you. I was talking about the emergency where either there's medical bills, there's a car accident, or somebody in my family really needed something. So I built my loss of income fund slowly over time. And before I knew it, I had $20,000 between both my savings and loss of income fund. And even though I didn't have enough money saved in my loss of income fund to survive 6 months without a job, it did a lot for my confidence. The cool thing about this was I had all my money separated, so it wasn't right in front of me and it was out of sight, out of mind, so I didn't get tempted to spend any of it. If you want to know my secret weapon for separating my accounts and saving money in the quickest way possible, you'll definitely want to check this video out up here after this video. Those weren't the only places I put my money into though. Like I said earlier, I wanted to explore other ways to invest. So I didn't know this back then, but compared to other investments you can make, 401ks really don't grow that fast, and they actually limit you on what you can invest in. So I'm really glad I stuck with only putting 4% of my money into my 401k because I was able to make some pretty good money on the side with these other investments. For one, I had about $3,000 into an Acorns account, and even though I don't use them that much anymore, the money I did have in there grew quite a bit. But the biggest thing I invested in was myself, and that's where the mistake started. For one, I invested a lot of money into something that I really didn't understand, and it wasn't a stock, bond, real estate, or anything like that. I invested in a business that I thought of as my own. And to be perfectly honest with you, this was mainly because the horrible experience I had at work made me not want to work for any other company ever again. It's just like when you eat something and you get food poisoning or you get a really upset stomach. That just ruins it for everything else. Oh, I just had some bad sushi? I ain't about to eat no more sushi. Same exact concept. Anyway, the business I invested in actually wasn't mine. It was an MLM, which is a multi-level marketing business where you sell products and then you recruit other people who also sell products. And I'm talking about stuff like lotions, snacks, energy drinks, you know, stuff you can get from the grocery store, only 1,000% more expensive. And when you get registered in an MLM, you technically become a business owner. I knew some people who did very well with it, and I needed an escape from work. And most of all, I just needed something to believe in because I needed to make income on the side so I could hopefully quit my job and become a full-time entrepreneur. I had so much faith in that business that I invested $600 a month into products while I would fail to recruit people over and over again. There's no profitability in that. You see, the way it's supposed to work is the more people I recruit, the more money I make. Since I invested $600 a month in products, if I was able to recruit 4 more people who also invested $600 in products, I'd be able to make some side income. And the more people I was able to recruit beyond that could potentially turn into hundreds of dollars a month going straight into my bank account. That didn't happen. Instead, I spent an entire year spending money on products that were actually really good, but they didn't do much for my pockets, let me tell you. Eventually, investing in myself paid off in the form of several hundreds of dollars in passive income every month, but that was years later, and that's a story for another day. But now I can't help but think, if only I knew about this one investment opportunity back then, and I put $600 in there every single month, I could be sitting on some serious money right now. And the investment I'm talking about is a Roth IRA. And this is something I kick myself about today because I was in the mindset of, well, I already have a 401k. I don't need to worry about any other retirement accounts. But think about this. I didn't max out my 401k, and that freed up a lot of money for me, as you saw. And I could have used that to invest in another retirement account. And of course, I didn't know this back then, but a Roth IRA has way more investment options than a 401k does. And so I could have had my money expanding outside of just my 401k, and it could have been growing much earlier on. You know what I'm saying? And something else I think about is how stuck I was on saving. I'll never forget, my mentor told me this years ago. He was like, hey man, you'll never get wealthy if all you do is save. And that was enough for me to wake up right there. And it comes full circle with this channel because I talk about saving money so much on this channel. And I talk a lot about living frugally on this channel, but it's time that I started going into detail on what the next steps are. Learning the strategies to save money is important and it can only help you, but you guys are gonna get so good at saving money to the point where your bank account is just gonna be piled up with cash. And if you really want to save money and you really want to build wealth, that's not the way. Bank accounts are for having money that you can easily get to when you need it. It's time to take a step forward and really look at how low the interest rates are in a bank account. Like most of them are less than 0.5%. And at the very most, they might be slightly more than 0.5% at like 0.7%. But are you honestly going to look at me and say that your money is growing in a bank account that only has a 0.7% interest rate? No, you're not. You're not. So if prices keep going up, I'm talking about gas, groceries, bills, all that good stuff. If all those prices go up at the same time at a faster rate than your money's growing in your bank account, you're going to find yourself in a situation where you're actually losing out on money just by keeping it in the bank. So I had to have that conversation with myself because like I said, I was stuck on saving. So I was like, you know what? Wouldn't it make more sense if I kept some of my money in my bank account and I put some of it into a growth account that I know is going to outpace inflation, so I know it grows over time? And wouldn't it make sense to put money in that account on a regular basis so it continues to grow over time? It makes sense to me because when it comes time to retire, I can enjoy more than just one retirement account. I can enjoy 2 retirement accounts and outside investments that surround those accounts. I looked around at work one day and I couldn't help but notice the amount of people that were over 60 working not because they wanted to, but because they had to. I'm going to tell you what I said to myself. That's not going to be me, especially when people told me how much were in their 401ks and they were like, yeah, I have $40,000, $50,000. I was like, dude, that's less than what you make in a year. That is scary. Stuff like that is exactly why I make videos. People just don't know. This stuff isn't taught in schools. I didn't know about this. I didn't know about 401ks or Roth IRAs or any other types of investments. I had to learn these things on my own. Matter of fact, I'm late to the Roth IRA game. I just set my account up yesterday. Facts. And granted, it's still early for me because I'm still young and I'm 25 years old and I still have several years of investing before it's time to, you know, retire. But still, could you imagine how much I would have now if I would have started in Roth IRA when I was the age 20? Let me go ahead and move on. I've been talking about this for too long. Now, this is one place where everyone knows they need to put their money, but this is also where a lot of people make mistakes, like life-altering mistakes. And I'm talking about debt. My experience with debt has been a very interesting one. So when I was saving money and learning along the way, I watched a lot of Dave Ramsey. I watched so much Dave Ramsey that my mindset became, oh, well, debt is the number one thing I've got to focus on. I've got to get rid of all this right now. When I tell you I went guns a-blazing, I kind of threw thousands of dollars at my debt at one time. Like, I knocked off $10,000 of debt so fast that my head was spinning. But around that same time, of course, was when I started to have those really bad experiences at work. And what that made me do is it made me take a step back and I was like, huh, these interest rates are really low. So I don't need to be throwing thousands of dollars at my debt. Why would I do that when I could just pay over the minimum payment without throwing thousands at it while still getting ahead with my savings account? So that way I'm saving money and I'm still putting a dent in my debt. I said to myself, you know, these people at work crazy. They don't care nothing about you. They don't care that you have debt. And they definitely don't care that you're just a young man out here just trying to make it. You look at them the wrong way, you blink the wrong way. They'll get rid of you in a heartbeat without any hesitation. So it would be a shame if you did all this work, throwing all these thousands at your debt, working overtime, throwing your overtime money at your debt, and they just fired you. What's stopping them from firing you? They did it to him. They can do it to you. By the way, if you want a more in-depth version of this story, you can check out this video up here, and you can also learn the money habits I picked up just from going through that horrible experience. Anyways, people somehow get it in their heads that paying off debt is more important than it actually is. It's still important, but in my opinion, it's not a race, and you don't get some badge of honor just from getting out of debt the quickest. What I think is more important is that you save and invest while you pay off your debt. Because think about it, it takes the average student 10 years to pay off their loans, and that's average, so there's obviously more and there's less. I don't think it's a wise decision to put saving and investing on hold for that long, especially when the interest rates on your debt aren't even that high. Especially when the interest rates on your debt aren't even that high. And what really brings this point home is the entire year of 2020, when everything just hit at once. A lot of people felt it. So what if you just wiped your entire bank account clean, paying off your debt, and then all of a sudden, boom, a pandemic happens that has impacted the entire world and you get laid off from your job because of it? Sure, you're debt-free, but now you're hurting. And to add insult to injury, they add a forbearance on any person who has student loans, so majority of them don't even accumulate any interest throughout that entire time. When it comes to money, your future has to be on your mind. Now, stuff like credit cards, stuff like that has to be urgent because those interest rates are stupid. I'm talking 17% and up, deeper and deeper for your future self. And you probably won't be able to get out of it either, which is why I always recommend paying more than the minimum payment so you can offset the fact that the interest you owe is still going to be there until you pay the whole thing off. So I use my credit cards to my advantage. I honestly just swipe my credit cards on things that I already had the money for anyways, like groceries, gas, stuff like that. And what I did was I just paid them off and I slowly built my credit score up. And I did that intentionally to build my credit score up. And eventually I got it up to 750 and beyond. The key is if you want to stay away from credit card debt, just swipe it on stuff that you already have money for anyway that you would normally be spending your money on. That way you won't have to worry about having this expensive credit card bill every month. All in all, your money is yours to do whatever you want with, but it's also your responsibility. So hopefully my experiences and my stories gave you an idea of what it looks like to fall a few times and get right back up and get on the correct path to making your money grow, while also having a good amount of money in your bank account so you can still feel comfortable and still enjoy your life while you're building your wealth. Because that's what it's all about. Anyways, that's the video for today. Thank you so much for watching. My name is Reggie Bryant, and this channel is all about personal finance and personal growth so you can control you, control your finances, and control your life. Thank you so much for watching. I'll see you in the next video. Don't forget to subscribe. Stay cold.